& Bloom News Brief. More info at fullandbloom.com. Today, Ultimate Classic Rock reposted an interview they did with guitarist Jakey Lee back in 2013. The feature commemorates the release of Ozzy's Bark at the Moon, which was released on this day in history, November 15, 1983. On joining Ozzy's band during the Speak of the Devil tour. There was Tommy Aldridge on drums, Don Costa on bass, Lindsey Bridgewater on keyboards, and Ozzy Osbourne on drugs and alcohol, basically. At the time I was in the band, I can at least proudly say I'm pretty sure that was Ozzy Osbourne at his most fucked up. Back then, it didn't feel like a proud thing to say. But now, it's kind of like a badge of honor that I was there the whole time. It was interesting. On the making of Bark at the Moon, most of that was really me and Bob Daisley, because Ozzy would show up and kind of play around with the songs. I remember I had the riff for Bark at the Moon and I played that, and he said, "Oh, I love it. We'll call that one Bark at the Moon," because he already had the album title in mind. So he said, "That one's going to be Bark at the Moon." He'd come in with things like that, and then he'd drink, and he'd either pass out or leave, which left just me and Bob. We'd stay in the studio and flesh out the songs. It was fun working with Bob. He wrote all the lyrics, and he's a great lyricist. So yeah, me and Bob, we had a good working relationship. It was fun doing that record. On producer-engineer Max Norman, he was in an interesting position because he was starting to be well-known because of the Ozzy records. But because he wasn't well-known when Ozzy did those records, for Ozzy, he kinda had to be Ozzy's bitch. If Ozzy said something, he expected Max to do it, period. He didn't get a lot of input as far as that, although he had a lot of input with me because I was brand new at it. I'd never done a record, and he was really helpful for me as far as tightening up, doing two takes, and lining them up right. He helped me a lot, but he was kind of a little bit of an Ozzy whipping boy for Ozzy, and that's why he didn't get a chance to mix the record, which I think was a fuck up. I mean, he should have. He mixed the first two Ozzy records, and they're bitchin', but then Ozzy figured he could get somebody else better. I think at that point, that's when he switched from Jet Records to Sony. Sony were the big boys, and they said, "Max Norman? Who's he? Get somebody else." That's why Tony Bongiovi ended up mixing the record, even though he wasn't there for the recording. And that record could have sounded so much better, I think, if Max had been allowed to mix it. On getting writing credits during his time with Ozzy. On The Ultimate Sin, I did get credit because I got fucked out of the first one. I was promised that I would get credit because I was young and I was in the middle of Scotland recording. I didn't have a manager or a lawyer. It was just me. From the beginning, every musician, it's always hammered into them. Keep your publishing and keep your writing. So those were the only conditions that I had. Okay, I'm getting songwriting credit, right? I was always assured that yes, I'm getting publishing. Of course you are. When I didn't on the first record, it was upsetting. But I figured, okay, what am I going to do? I got fucked. What am I going to quit? We're about to tour on a record that I finally got to make. There's no problem for Ozzy to find another guitar player. Am I just going to be that guy that played on that record, didn't even get credit on the record, and then refused to tour because I had a problem with Ozzy? No, I had to go out and tour. It would have been stupid not to. So I was only able to put my foot down at the end of the tour. Let's make another record. And I was like, okay, but this time, you know what? I want the contract first before we start recording. I don't want to be a dick, but I don't want to get fucked again either. To read the entire interview, click the link in the description.